This is an MPB Think Radio podcast. To hear previous shows, visit mpbonline.org or download the MPB Public Radio app to listen on your iPhone or Android phone on demand.
Okie dokie, folks. Welcome back. Horticulturist Phil Lorenzi. Welcome back. Welcome, period. Glad you're here this morning. We're going to be talking about gardening and all things gardening, pretty much only things gardening, because that's what this Gestalt Gardener program is about. Me and Java and all the other folks here at MPB, we're going to be having a good time just laughing and talking. So if you could interrupt our jubilee and with your misery, I know some of your tomatoes are wilting. I know you got chinch bugs in your grass. I know that, you know, you're out there, the squash flowers are falling off, because it's happening to me too. But, you know, we're going to be doing the best we can to try to figure stuff out, fix it as best we can, and learn how to just flow with the rest of it. If you want to give us a call, it's toll free, 1-877-MPB-RING. Before we go to any calls, I want to give a shout out to Fulton, Mississippi, Itawamba County.
You did it, man. You did it.
That's right. You know, over the past 40 years, I started with Extension Service in 1980. That's 42 years ago.
Four years before I was born.
That's right. I was BSing before you were born, Job. Anyway, this is the – I've lectured in 42 states. I've lectured in 81 counties, and as of this past Tuesday and Wednesday, all 82 counties. I had a great time in Itawamba County.
There you go.
Yeah, we were at the library there in Fulton. It was packed Tuesday night. It was packed Wednesday morning. And people were coming in and asking about you. One guy named Chico.
Oh, we know Chico.
Chico, yeah. He calls pretty regularly. He brought a handmade sign that said Felder 40. No, the Felder 82.
There you go.
In Fulton. Appreciate that. But one last thing. Sarah Skelton made, she's from the Eggville community. Shout out to the Eggville community.
Okay.
She made a t-shirt. It's got bees on it. It's got grass and all. And it's got great big letters that says, Mow High. We have become a brand?
That's your, yeah. That's one of your many slogans. Yeah. Catchphrases. Yeah, that's a brand, man.
Mohai and let's get dirty.
Let's go.
It got to be another one. Got to be another one. Anyway, I really appreciate it, Sarah. It's a wonderful T-shirt, and we're going to post a picture of it on our podcast this
week.
I just sent it to you. Anyway, Java, I need to calm down.
Man, you're coming off a high, man. You accomplished a goal.
It was fun.
And it sounds like it was rocking and rolling.
It was fun. Now, I went around, stole some flowers out of people's yards to talk about and that kind of stuff. That's one of my other brands, too. I always work something in. So, anyway, if you want to give us a call, it's toll-free 1-877-MPB-RING. And I see Francis from Natchez. Hey, Francis, good morning.
Good morning.
What's up?
Thanks for having me on again.
Sure.
I got a question and a comment.
Okay, keep the comment clean.
Yeah, they clean.
Okay.
But question, I've got azalea bushes in my yard, and when is the best time? I got one that I want to relocate to another part of my yard. When is the best time to dig them up and relocate them?
Well, you can do it any time you get around to it. The worst time is right now. Because, you know, plants need all the roots they can get. It's about to get hot and dry, and those leaves are sucking on those roots, trying to stay alive. And when you dig a plant, you leave the fingertips of the roots behind. So the best time would be sometime in the late fall or the winter time when the plants aren't moving. That's ideal. I've moved stuff in the wrong season. Sometimes it made it. So I'm not saying you can't, but I would, you know, what you might want to do this year is take a shovel, and if you know about how big a root ball you're going to move, let's say you're going to dig a root ball 2 feet across. Well, go around and make four cuts, north, south, east, and west, that far out. In other words, cut half the roots this year. Now, it's not enough to kill the plant, but it'll make those roots start bunching out, so it'll have a whole lot more roots to move. Sort of like, it's pruning roots, just like pruning a shrub. So make a couple of cuts, maybe three cuts, maybe four cuts, but don't dig it up, and get it ready to be moved.
Gotcha. Now, my comment is, a cousin of mine told me, I got gardenia bushes all over my place.
Mm-hmm.
That you could eat the petals of the flower of the gardenia. Did you know that?
I did not. I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised.
Good.
Well, you tasted one?
Oh yeah.
Okay. Well, I mean, I'm gonna get on it because I've talked a lot about edible flowers. Never really thought about that. So interesting. We'll find out for sure. But you're saying that you did it and you're still with us.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Now do us both a do me a favor, but don't do yourself a favor. Go out of your gardenia with a piece of paper in your hand and hold it right under flower and thump the flower really hard on the piece of paper 3 or 4 times. And then look real close at the piece of paper and you'll see what else you're eating.
my
vegan friends might not appreciate me saying this, but there's meat in those flowers. They're called thrips. This is what makes the white flowers turn yellow, tiny little cigar-shaped things. And they're okay, but if you're a vegan, don't be eating your gardenias.
Gotcha. Thanks,
appreciate your call, man. Thank you. We went to a restaurant in Memphis a couple of weeks ago, some vegan friends of ours, and they ordered bacon and eggs and all that kind of stuff, and it looked like bacon. I'm thinking, if you don't want to eat bacon, why you make it look like bacon? You call it bacon. Come up with your own words.
That's true. That's the thing
I got no problems with it, but come on. Let's stop fooling ourselves.
There's something
ain't bacon.
On social media where a lady made vegan chicken wings to look like chicken wings. Like, what are we doing here?
Yeah. I mean, you do the cauliflower wings.
Yeah, but I don't call them buffalo. I don't call them buffalo chicken wings. I call them cauliflower wings.
Cauliflower's got wings. Anyway, let's go up to Tupelo and talk to Clay. Hey, Clay, how are you?
Good, Felder. Thank you for taking my call.
You bet.
We bought a property 3 years ago, just 15 acres, and kind of develop it into like the permaculture type stuff.
Uh-huh, yeah.
We have a lot of livestock and gardens and stuff, and I planted around 3 years ago, I planted about 15 fruit trees. So it'd be pear and apple and plum, pretty much.
You got the right kind for North Mississippi?
Yes, sir. Yes,
good,
I researched it when I did it, and that was what they told me. Persimmons and fig trees. What I was wondering, I've been reading this guy, and he calls it the stun method. I think it's just something he came up with called sheer total utter neglect.
Yeah.
And he just plants trees and lets them go, and that's kind of how I remember my granddaddy doing it. And I was just wondering, if you just plant the fruit trees and never prune them and stuff like that, you know, just have them all out. They're growing really good and stuff, but.
Well,
how that would work.
The problem is, it's like your facial hair. You know, you could just let it go too, but you're going to end up with cooties in it if you don't do something to it. Okay, so pruning fruit trees, this is horticulture. By the way, this goes back thousands of years that people have been pruning fruit trees. I mean, they have pictures of Egyptians pruning fruit trees. So, you know, well, not pictures, they got hieroglyphics or whatever. But it's really important for a couple of reasons. One is it makes the plants branch out closer to the ground. So not only do the trees open, get better air circulation, you have more twigs with more fruit, and you can reach it. Instead of stuff way up at the top, it also keeps the plants healthier because instead of spending a lot of energy on a lot of top growth, it puts its energy into fewer branches, means more energy is going to go to the fruit. So it is, I think, if nothing else, Clay, when you first set a fruit tree out, if nothing else, the day you put it out, cut it back to about knee or thigh high. If you just do that, it's going to make it branch out close to the ground. It's going to be sturdier, healthier. You're going to be able to reach the fruit a whole lot better. But as far as just walking away from it, you can do that. But all you're doing is you're limiting yourself, you know.
Right.
And sort of like, you know, kids, it's great to have kids, but you got to teach them to stay out of the road, you know.
Right.
Say, well, fruit trees, you know, you got to keep them. You don't have to. You know, what he's doing, he's saying – he's saying I'm lazy. I don't know what to do. I'm just not gonna do anything. You know, we know that pruning the fruit trees, at least the year you set them out, and maybe thinning out the clutter the second year, that starts them all strong and sturdy and wide and more fruit quicker in the life of the tree.
Okay, so then 3 years after not doing that, so I want to start that. What would be the best time to start that?
Yes, it's not going to be good. You know, if you'll imagine you're holding an apple in your hand with your fingers all the way around it, with the apple pointing towards the sky, and then take the apple out, your hand is sort of spread out, your fingers like that. That's what commercial fruit trees look like because they cut the middle of it out first. So if you can, if you got some good sturdy side branches, you can cut out some of the tall clutter in the middle of it. But and I think 3 years, you can still get away with doing that. Main thing is make it where you have limbs growing out and up instead of the tree growing straight up. What this guy's saying, he said he wants fruit trees. I'm assuming you want tree fruit. And so at least cut middle out. And by the way, try some of the Japanese persimmons if you get a chance. They are terrific producers.
Is that the one? Fuyu?
Yeah. That's a really good one.
I planted one of those. Yeah.
Good.
And time of year on that pruning?
Well, you know, if you're just thinning a few things out here and there, you know, you can do that anytime you get around to it. It's easier on you, and you can see better what you're doing in the wintertime. But, you know, if you'll go out there and cut out some of the cluttered tall stuff in the middle of the trees, you can do that now if you get out there in the morning before it gets too hot.
Okay. On the production second year, they produce fruit. This year, they don't seem to be doing anything. Would that be like from a late freeze that we got, hard freeze?
Could very well be. You know, everything depends, not just the type of fruit, but also the varieties. You know, varieties of fruit trees tell time by the amount of cold they get in the wintertime. And some don't need much at all, and they do best on the coast. But if you plant those up in north, they're going to bloom in the middle of the winter. See, so chilling hours is real important.
All right. Well, I appreciate it, Felder.
Well, I want to ask you something. What do you do about deer?
We don't have them. We just not where we have them all around, but they don't. We have two livestock guardian dogs that bark all night.
Well, that helps because otherwise I could hear the birds in the background. And, you know, if you say I don't have a problem with deer, you can. If you open your window further, you'll hear people all over the South laughing about that. It's just a matter of time.
Our dogs are trained to protect the goats, and so anything that comes on the property, they're pretty vocal about.
Cool. Go scratch them in the ears for me.
Thank you.
You bet. Yeah, just walking away from it. Planting it, walking away from it. That sounds fun, but that ain't the way it works.
That's not going to get you what you want.
Yeah. Hey, let's slide down to Lauderdale County to Meridian. Good morning, Aaron. How are you this morning?
I'm doing good, Felder. How you doing, man?
So far, so good. I hadn't gotten in trouble that I know of.
Well, good deal. If so, you'll get a letter later on. It'll be fine.
What you got going on? What's up?
I've got, in my yard, it used to be an old cutover, and they replanted, and this has been years ago, they replanted the pine trees, and then we got pine beetles. And it wiped out the border of our yard just to the old cutover.
Yeah.
And it looks terrible. They kind of stopped. We cut down the trees that were, you know, I guess infested with the pine beetles. And
right.
I guess more or less it stopped them, but it now looks like a war zone.
Yeah.
And I have thought about putting up a fence, you know, to kind of just border the yard from the ugly cutover, but the way wood is, that's going to be pretty expensive.
Yeah.
And a friend of mine, years ago, he put up, he lives on a dirt road, and every time he lives in a curve, and every time somebody would come around that curve, it'd kick up dust, you know, all over the place.
Right.
So he put up bamboo. And it didn't overtake his yard. It didn't, you know, it stayed pretty much where he planted it. And I mentioned that the other day to my brother, who's, I guess, an arborist. He cuts down trees. And he looked at me like I said I was going to put rattlesnake pits to border my yard. But, man, that's a terrible idea. And I've seen several people do it. And I've even seen videos on YouTube of, you know, them putting it up. But I didn't know if there was a certain type of bamboo or if that was just – and somebody mentioned – the possibility of it not being legal. He said, you need to check on the legality of that. So
okay,
I'm just going to get your input on that.
Okay, first of all, it's not illegal to plant bamboo. You know, it's just not, you know, it's just like it's not illegal to cut down a magnolia tree. People worry about that. Matter of fact, well, I was down in South Alabama, and I was looking at some gardens, and this lady came out and caught me looking at her yard, and she said that she had to cut down a magnolia tree, and everybody said, you can't do that. It's not illegal. But here's the deal. There's two main kinds of bamboo. There's clump-forming kind, and there's what they call the running kind that sends out runners and makes just a wall of vegetation. The running kind is the one that's going to give you the screen. If you've got the room and it's your property, you can go for it. But just understand that after it gets established and starts doing exactly what you want, it's going to say, see that house over there? I'm going to eat that.
Okay.
So as long as you can mow, or if you'll put a little ditch, you know, over the years, just between it and where you don't want it, just put a little shallow ditch, then it's not going to cross that ditch, at least not in our lifetime. So.
Okay.
But now,
how big should that ditch be?
Well, it's a concept more than a recipe. They don't. You know, they send these their rhizomes. It's like a root, but it's right under the ground, and you know, they're pretty shallow, and you're just trying to keep them on one side of something or the other. Well, let me throw this out. Meanwhile, it's going to take a while. You plant this stuff, and it's going to be a while before it gets thick enough to really help much. If you were shading your eyes from the sun, you would use just one hand, and you'd move it around to where it's just right between you and the sun. Well, you can put a small fence between you and that, but it doesn't have to go all the way to the ground like a fence. Imagine a fence that starts about 3 or 4 feet off the ground and only goes up 5 or 6 or 7 feet, just like a miniature billboard.
Okay,
these are called baffles. You can do it with wood. You can put 3 inches of space between the boards if you want to. All you're trying to do is just sort of put something in the foreground that's like your hand shading your eyes from the sun.
Right.
And you could put that fairly close to the house and takes that entire view away. You could put 2 or 3 of them at different spots, you know, just move them around. Like if you had 3 hands and we had 3 suns, you'd know what to do with them.
Right. Okay.
And you can use lattice, and you can grow a vine on it. You can put birdhouses on the post, whatever. But just put something out there. It's called a baffle, like a miniature billboard. Paint it, plant a vine on it, and you're not even going to worry about all that other stuff.
I have not even thought about that. Okay. Sounds good then. And just put like a friend of mine has I guess it's a vining rose bush, but it looks like a vine, but it's a rose bush.
Yeah.
You put on a picket fence and it runs all the way across. It looks great.
You could do that. You could do gourds. You know, you could do almost anything, you know, but the idea is it just sections of a miniature fence, the top half of a fence stuck here and there. Does that make sense?
All right, ma'am. Yeah, it does. I appreciate it.
All righty. Hey, send me a picture of it and paint it and put a birdhouse and send me a picture of it.
Will do. Appreciate it, man.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Appreciate it. And by the way, Java, years ago when I first started going to England, we lived on a farm that had everything. They had an ancient orchard with apples and pears and all like that, and the owners let goats loose in it. And we went out one morning, and the goats were standing in the trees, eating the trees. So this guy who called earlier said he's got goats and a dog, you know, a couple of dogs and goats and fruit trees. You know, choose 2 of those 3, because the 3 of them ain't going to get along. Goats will eat. Goats, let me back it up. Let me be positive. Yes, don't worry about pruning your fruit trees. Just put the goats in with them.
They're going. I've seen pictures.
We're going to take a quick break, folks. Horticulturist Felder Rush and Java Chapman here at Mississippi Public Broadcasting. The lines are wide open. Give us a call. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Jason Klein from Fix It 101. If you ever thought about changing the doorknob or fixing a leaky faucet, some jobs just aren't that difficult, and yes, you can do it. If you want to find out how to do those things, listen to Fix It 101, podcast everywhere.
Okay, folks, Horticulturist Felder Rush, we're going to be talking about gardening. If you got something on your mind, it's toll-free, 1-877-MPB ring, and got the lines wide open, so there's a good chance to yak about stuff. Java, you know somebody
Francis from Natchez.
Yeah, but somebody when I was in Fulton, they said they noticed how as soon as somebody asked a question, you come in with some interesting facts about it. I'm thinking, because he reads. Oh. You know, you look stuff up, and Francis from Natchez wanted to know about eating gardenias, and you came up with a recipe.
Yeah, I just typed in gardenia petals, you know, edible, and I found this recipe. I give the website cookinglight.com, which is all about, you know, cooking well, you know, cooking for health and stuff like that. And it said gardenia petals are fine to be eaten raw by themselves. You do want to be careful about where you get them from. They should be, of course, pesticide free.
Yeah.
And they was like, most florists are not going to be your source, but if you can find some people who grow them, you know, the right way or just without pesticides.
But yeah, just walk around your yard.
Yeah. And then they had this little recipe, simple recipe for crystallized gardenia petals. A lot of people use them to top on top of cakes and cupcakes and stuff like that. It's flower petals, egg wash, a small paintbrush and some sugar, and you coat them with the egg wash, put the sugar on top, let them dry for about 2.5 hours, and then they get kind of crispy.
Okay, well, it sounds like crystallized toenails to me.
But yeah, it's a real thing. I mean, hey, it's a sweet treat.
But you also mentioned that, and I didn't know this, that gardenias are in the coffee family.
Yeah, just typing it in, gardenia is a genus of flowering plants in the coffee family, native of tropical, subtropical regions, Africa, Asia, Madagascar, and, you know, all over Mississippi.
Yeah. Well, one thing I would suggest, though, because gardenias and rose petals are edible, too, this insect called thrips, you're not going to see them unless you actually go looking for them. You know, it's not like trouble just waiting for you to find it. Thrips are real small, so if you're going to do rose petals or gardenia petals, rinse them first.
Yeah. Also, it says you can strain these. It's so fascinating. You can strain these petals and make like a honey. If you soak the petals in honey and strain them, it makes a sweet tea concentrate. So it's a lot going on with the gardenias.
That sounds like you do the same thing again with toenails, though. You soak toenails in.
Well, who wants to do that?
Well, I made a cake one time, and I put a sign on that said, "Find the toenail." But you know, there wasn't a toenail there, but it kept it. But I kept the whole cake for myself.
I thought it was a plan with that action.
You know, we've gone from way up in North Mississippi. We've gone both sides of the side, going down the sides. Let's go all the way down to the coast of Long Beach. Hey, Leela, how are you this morning?
Hey, I'm good. How are you?
Fine. Enjoying this day.
Well, we've got a little overcast. It's a little warm, but not nearly what it has been.
Yeah, or going to be. So yeah, what's up this morning?
Well, zucchini is up, but it's not really doing well. Here's what happened. I had some wonderful plants producing well, and you can guess what I got.
Squash vine borers.
You got it. So the first two that I found, I had not looked at the YouTube video that said, just carefully get the worm out.
Mm-hmm.
And so I tore them up, not realizing.
Oops.
And then I looked it up. Well, so I've got some more out there. Here's my problem. They're in raised beds. And, you know, we've been so dry down here. The only time we did have rain, it came in 2 days and it was 6 inches and then
it
was gone.
Yeah.
And now we're going to get in a dry front tonight. Today is rain, but then it's going to, the humidity's going down, which is you know. But I'm having a real hard time keeping the water, keeping the moisture in those raised beds.
Yeah.
And I've got leaves thick on top and everything. And I know that I had emailed you a while back, and basically you said water thoroughly, but don't water frequently.
Yeah.
Well, if I don't, it's like they're completely hanging their tongues out, you know?
Yeah. This is a real issue, you know, and keep in mind, you're talking to a guy who's gone for weeks and sometimes months at a time, and now ain't nobody going to water my plants. See, so I've got to train them to have as deep root as possible. And I grow stuff in raised beds, but also a big 6 foot diameter horse watering trough, and you know, made out of corrugated tin. So I understand what you're saying. Here's the deal: next time you work your dirt up, see if you could add your soil. See if you could add some real dirt to it. See if you can find somebody that sells, and I don't mean, you know, whatever they're selling is topsoil, real dirt. You know, some places sell it, and it's just dirt. What that does, that firms up your soil. It stays moist longer than organic matter and sand and stuff. And so if you'll firm your soil up a little bit by adding some real dirt to it, that'll help somewhat. But and using the mulch helps a lot. But other than, you know, you might want to consider putting a soaker hose out there. You know, just coil it around under your mulch. And you can even have it where it's on a timer and it comes on for 15 minutes three times a week. You know, to keep the soil.
My next step.
Yeah, okay, but keep in mind.
My flower bed.
Yeah, keep in mind, soaker hoses and drip irrigation, they're not made to water plants. They're made to keep the soil moist. So, you know, just don't turn it on and think it's going to water down deep. You know, if you'll use it frequently, you know, every week or maybe three times a week, that'll keep the soil moist without, you know, drying out that, you know, wet, dry spell.
Yeah, okay. Well, I appreciate it because I've just gotten frustrated. And let me ask you this also. I did add more, and it's, you know, your typical buy at the store garden. It's called garden soil.
And never good enough. I've been doing this a long time. That stuff is never right.
What about the little white bags that you get at the local big box that are just labeled topsoil?
That's mostly screened bark. You need dirt, D-I-R-T, dirt.
Yeah.
is your raised bed, is it sitting on top of just ground or sitting on top of something else?
Well, I have half a barrel, you know, size one with the zucchini in it.
Yeah, I guess what I'm
sitting on top of concrete.
Okay, okay.
So that I don't have to bend over.
Yeah, okay. I'm just saying, you know, a lot of times you can dig down into the dirt beneath and bring it up and mix stuff with it. But so you don't have a raised bed, you got a big pot. And big pots
I have two raised beds as well.
Okay.
But again, they're not to the ground.
Well, then if they're sitting on top of the ground, that's a pot. I don't care what shape it is. A raised bed is partly sunk and partly raised. You're digging down and adding stuff to sort of, it's partly sunk and partly raised. You just got big old pots. And the soaker hose are going to be your best bet.
Okay, so should I go in the corner where I used to have a kind of a compost pile and dig and get that dirt?
If it's dirt, you want dirt, not organic matter, not compost, not manure, not tops. You want just plain old D-I-R-T dirt. And sometimes garden centers sell it by the bag.
Okay. The reason I ask is because I'm afraid of the weeds that are going to come in with it.
Well, you can have weeds anyway. That's what mulch is for.
Okay.
So I'm trying to help. This is what I do. If there was an easier way, I would do it. But once you add real dirt, part other stuff, it's like crackers and chili. You got a bowl full of crackers. You need to add some chili to it.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay. And by the way, using bird netting, insect netting over your, that'll keep the insects out. You just have to hand pollinate your squash if you want to.
Yeah, well, I haven't had too bad of a problem except for this.
Yeah.
Because
these
weird little bugs I had on there, I grab and just kill them.
There you go. Well, good luck on it. And by the way, another word for D-I-R-T dirt is C-L-A-Y, clay.
For my front yard, really?
Yeah, okay. We got Scoot. Have fun digging that whatever you can find and mix it in.
Now, Felder, you said hand pollinate the squash. Is that what we did last week?
Yeah. You know, I get a lot of questions. You know, this Mississippi Gardening Facebook page, a lot of people, their little squash is shriveling up, falling off, because they're not squash unless they get pollinated. They're just part of a female flower.
Yeah.
And if you don't have bees, you got to do it, you know, use a male, like a little paintbrush. Anyway, we're going to take a quick break. Have you got some music queued up?
I do.
Is it cheerful music?
I think it is. You sent it.
That's right. We got calls from Fulton, from Oxford, from
Polk.
We're going to take a real quick break, come back in a couple of minutes or so. So if y'all would bear with us, we're going to get some more coffee. We're going to play with my Mohai t-shirt that Sarah from Eggville made for me. And we're going to be talking about gardening right here on Mississippi Public broadcast. We'll be right back.
Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, that grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Ain't
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bang. Forget about your scene, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance and out.
And always look on the bright side of life.
Alrighty, folks, welcome back. Horticulturist Felder Rushing, and we're going to go up to a place where I finally made it after all these years, to Fulton, Mississippi. Becky, how are you this morning? Thanks for holding.
Thank you. Doing fine. How are you doing, Mr. Felder?
So far, so good.
Well, good. I called to find out how I could go about purchasing one of those pass-along plants books that you signed the other day. I didn't get to get one, and I wanted to get one. I don't know, you know, I need to send, you know, how I need to go about that.
Oh, you could just go to Amazon. You know, if the local bookstore doesn't have it, you know, just go online. You can probably get it online cheaper than I can buy them.
No, I know. I just wanted to get it signed, and I didn't know, you know. But anyway.
Well, yeah, shoot me an email. We'll see if we can work something out.
Okay.
Yeah, go to felderrushing.blog, not .net, not .com, but .blog, and it's got a big old button that says email me.
Okay, I will. But I wanted to tell you, we really enjoyed it the other day. Thank you so much for coming. And
I figured y'all not going to invite me back, so we blew it out.
I don't know about that.
Yeah. Well, we appreciate it. I did have a lot of fun, really. And I enjoyed riding around Fulton, too. That was fun.
Well, thank you so much.
All righty. Well, thank you. Shoot me an email.
Okay. I do have one more question, if that's okay.
Sure.
Okay. I just wondered about, since I live in an apartment, I was wondering about, you know, you showed pictures of that guy in Jackson that does...
the gorilla gardening.
That gorilla gardening.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering, you know, should I do pot gardening? I mean,
Becky, I grow a lot of stuff in pots, you know, and, you know, I don't plant much stuff for the summer because I'm gone a lot, you know, and nobody's going to water, but I grow lots of stuff, 5-gallon buckets, you know, any kind of, you know, the bigger the pot, the less often you got to water it, and you can plant 2 or 3 things in one big pot, a lot easier. You can have a bunch of little pots could be watered and that blow over and all that kind of stuff. But it's easy to grow culinary herbs. You know, I showed a picture of my pickup truck with all that stuff growing in the back. That's just a big pot stuck up against the cab of my truck.
Okay.
So
I just wondered about, you know, I don't know whether or not I could do gardenias and that sort of stuff. But
Well, you could, but you can just walk around town and smell gardenias. Grow something you can't get from your neighbors. You know, put you some basil and rosemary and oregano and a pepper plant and maybe some zinnias. And then just when you get a hankering for gardenias, just walk around the corner. They're everywhere.
Okay.
Yeah. It's called a bar. That's part of gorilla gardening. Gorilla gardening means not on your property. Anyway.
Okay, thank you.
You bet, Becky. Thanks for calling. Okay, now let's slide down to Oxford. Mary, good morning. What's going on in your neck of the woods?
Well, I'm concerned, very concerned, because my dogwood tree leaves are all crinkling up. So I'm afraid it's got the blight. So what do I do?
And what kind of tree is it that's all curling up?
Dogwood
tree. You know, dogwoods, you know, they're native plants, and you see them everywhere, but you only see the ones that are blooming. I see the ones that didn't make it. Dogwoods are really popular, but they're fickle. They're hard to pull off. And, you know, if it's a, is this a fairly new tree or is it an old tree?
No. These are very old trees.
Well, there are some blights, but also just plain bad weather. You know, dogwoods have got a kind of a weird root system. They don't have a strong root like an oak or something. And a root will grow this way, and some will grow that way, and some won't grow in any direction. And if it stays really dry for a long time, those roots get damaged. And if it stays really wet a long time, those roots get damaged. So back and forth and back and forth. And over the time, dogwoods just build up root damage from just bad weather. You know, even in the woods, they die. So unfortunately, other than watering during dry spells, there's not much we can do. Cutting out some of the limbs takes some of the stress off, takes some of the workload off. So if you'll go out and the limbs that aren't looking great, go ahead and cut those out. You'll end up with a funny-looking tree, but they're funny-looking anyway. They're big bonsais. So if you can thin out some of the weaker stuff, then that'll, the energy that would have gone to those will go to what's left. That helps. But there's not any cure for any kind of blights or anything.
Oh, darn.
You know, this is, you know, and, you know, that song, always look on the bright side of life. You can always hang Mardi Gras beads on, you know, on the limbs. Whatever it takes, you know, because there's not much, if you can't fix it, flee it, or fight it, just flow with it.
Uh-huh. Okay, well, thank you.
Okay. Good luck on it.
Thanks.
Oh. It might not have been what they wanted. My dog was dying. Well, put some Mardi Gras beads on. Don't worry about it.
You didn't give Mary much to go on. But I don't think
I'm real bottom line. Mm-hmm. I'm real bottom line. You know, it's just like I have hair growing on my ears. Well, I pluck them as best I can, but after a while, you just go with it. You know, put an earring on and nobody will notice. Maybe. We'll see. Hey, let's go to, is this Polk? Ben's calling, is
Pope.
It Pope? Okay,
yeah.
Where is that? I think I've been there, but I can't remember.
It's 5 miles south of Batesville.
Oh, yeah.
On Highway 51.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I've been through there. What's up?
Felder, is it feasible to make cuttings off of a gardenia bush, root them, and start bushes from them?
Not only is it feasible, it's one of the easiest plants there is to root. I'm rooting some right now. And here's what you do, Ben. You go out and find a gardenia that's blooming, and it blooms on this year, what grew this year. That's the part that'll root, not the old woody stems. Cut a twig off that's 4 or 5 inches long, pluck the flower and any buds off, and strip off all but two or three of the leaves, stick it in some water. It'll have roots in 3 weeks.
Oh, great. I'm fixing to do that then.
Yeah.
I just wanted to make sure before I tried it, because everything I try to do like that works out. Don't work out.
Well, try this, you know, and again, 4, 5, 6 inch long cuttings, all but two or three of the leaves, pluck off any flowers, stick them in some water. And I tell you, the real trick to it is root it in a Coca-Cola bottle. There's something magic about Coca-Cola bottles.
Okay, now, as soon as they get roots, then can I go ahead and put it in the ground?
You can put it in the ground. If you while it's rooting, it's going to take about 3 weeks to root. That'll give you time to dig a nice hole. Don't try to do it all at once. It's too hot.
Okay. But now, how many little pieces should I do to make a bush? 5 or 6?
Oh, just one. One will make
a bush?
Yeah, heck yeah. If you notice one, you cut it off, follow it all the way down, ain't but one trunk coming up out of the ground. That was one plant that somebody else rooted.
Yeah. Okay, I got a great old big bush. Somebody put two or three of them in the ground.
Well, they do that to make it
so big.
They make it good. You know, that's what we call, let me see, I'm trying to, I can't think of it. It's a cosmetic surgery. They're making something bigger than it's normal.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Felder.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
I was going to say, what, stacking the deck?
Stacking the deck. Thank you. Appreciate you helping me out on that. You know, it's hot and humid, but apparently it's going to be kind of low humidity the next few days. The dirt's good. This is a good time to go out, not today because the ground's still wet, but a day or two after a good rain, dirt turns over like chocolate cake. Good time to dig. Garden centers are loaded with plants, lots of stuff. And, you know, a lot of people plant their vegetables early and they start petering out about now. Well, this is a good time to replant because we got lots of summer ahead of us.
And if you really want to have some fun, you can go rent a tiller.
Oh, yeah, rent a tiller. It will wear you out, but rent one. And it's so much easier than owning one when you got to take care of it and
you know,
keep oil in it and find a place to keep it and all like that. Just rent one and wear it out and take it back.
Yeah, we did that a couple of years back. Had some fun.
Yeah. Okay, now, I've got this thing for – so is this from – Ann from – I can't read that, Java.
Tennessee.
Ann, what's going on? What part of Tennessee?
Southwest.
Okay, that sounds like Memphis to me.
Well, it's equidistant between Memphis and Nashville in Savannah, Tennessee.
Okay, you're north of Jackson then.
I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, what's up?
I know we're east of them. Oh, just I have a very healthy petunia bush.
Right.
And it's about 12 feet or so. And I thought, well, I'm not going to prune it this winter or early spring. And it's going fine, except all these top branches are kind of like getting so tall and gangly that they're kind of leaning forward towards the street away from the house.
Yeah.
And I know I'm worried about pruning it. I think it might be okay, but I'm worried about pruning it because they said then that you can open it up for that disease it gets.
Okay. Well, first of all, that disease is going to be there anyway. It's called endomysporium. It makes little bird's eye spots on the leaves.
Yes.
And it doesn't matter if it's pruned or not. You know, matter of fact, opening it up makes it better because a real thick plant, when people plant them close together, that causes, that lowers the air circulation and you end up with more disease. So pruning actually helps on that. But now here's the deal. You know, to give you some confidence. And keep in mind, I've done this countless times. I'm not just saying you could do that. Here's what I've done. You could cut them to knee high and it's going to sprout back out. So if you want to cut it above there, it's okay. I'm just saying it does not hurt a photinia or a gardenia or you know how people prune roses down to a foot or foot and a half tall every winter and they come back out? Same thing with these. They just happen to be evergreen.
Okay, that sounds wonderful. So just one last follow-up question, if you don't mind, on another topic, crepe myrtle. Mm-hmm. I have a beautiful crepe myrtle, and I read about how to propagate them, and they said just take, you know, they explained about cutting some of the ends of the good branches or the suckers that come up and put them in sand and water. Is that what?
Every
4 to 8 weeks?
Every crepe myrtle you see on earth was grown from a cutting 6 inches to a foot long. Every single one.
Okay.
I would go with pencil size cutting, not that little skinny stuff on the ends of the branches and not the big thick woody stuff, but stuff that's about the size and diameter of a pencil, if you're old enough to remember what a pencil is.
Yeah, number two pencil. That's
right.
Favorite.
That's right. Just remember which end is the eraser in when you stick it in the dirt.
But do you agree with what they said about, I just looked online real quick, about putting in and just sand and a little water and doing each one individually for 4 to 8 weeks?
You go to 15 websites. They're all going to have their own recipe. Basically, you want to keep it moist in some kind of soil that stays moist but not wet and doesn't dry out too fast. A pretty good potting soil. Mix some sand with it. That'll work. That works fine.
All right.
Okay.
I'm excited.
I want to give you another quick tip about your photinia, though. Wherever you make a cut, the new growth is going to come out right there. So if you cut it straight across, it's going to put out growth straight across like a witch's broom. So cut the branches at different heights, whatever, you know, sort of a cone shape if you want to, a taller stuff in the middle, a short around the edge, and cut it below where you want it to grow back up to, because every cut, that's where the new growth comes out. And then when the new growth does come out, before it gets more than a foot or two long, cut the ends of it off. So instead of shooting up tall and skinny, each one of those new branches will bush out. So cut it lower than you want, and then tip prune the new growth when it comes out.
Yeah, when it gets to be about a foot or so.
Oh, just after it comes out. Don't worry about how long.
Oh, okay. Well, you are just a wellspring of knowledge.
Well, this stuff, you know, my grandmother showed me how to do this. You know, I pruned shrubs as a kid with a lawnmower, and they sprouted back out, luckily. So that's how I know you can cut things way back. So,
Oh, anyway. My gosh. Well, yeah.
Have fun.
I will tell you just real quick, the crepe myrtle, it was in a bed of irises when we moved here, but the previous owner had every spring. He just mowed over everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so it rescued itself when it stopped getting mowed over, and we didn't even know it was there. And it's just like huge and gorgeous now.
Told you.
That's right. Okay, well, God bless you all. Thank you so much, you and Java.
Thanks, Ann. Appreciate it. Thanks, Java.
Yeah, thank you, Ann, for calling. We love callers.
Yeah, we've got time for another couple of three calls. If you want to give us a call, the lines are wide open. Toll free 1-877. Don't we?
Yeah, we got a few minutes. I was debating on should we take this break or not.
Yeah, well, let's take a break. We've got some lines open. Somebody squeeze another call before we get back out in the Mississippi heat and humidity. We're going to take a quick break and come back. You know, between Java and Kevin Farrell and all the other folks here at MPB, we really appreciate you tuning in. If you do have questions or you want somebody to console you if you're having problems, go to Mississippi Gardening Facebook. If you're not a Facebook person, that's okay. But if you are, there's some kooky people on that site, but they're all gardeners. And they share, so here's how I do it. Well, here's how I do it. Well, you know, and there's scientists on there, you know, who say, here's how it's supposed to be done. Anyway, it's a nice community, Mississippi Gardening on Facebook. Otherwise, go to felderrushing.blog and hit that email me button. We're going to be right back with the Gestalt Gardener here on MPB right after this.
On Southern Remedy Healthy and Fit, you get information about foods you should eat to stay in good health and tips on how to stay active. I'm Dr. Josie Bidwell, host of Southern Remedy Healthy and Fit, an associate professor of preventive medicine at the University of Mississippi Medical Center. Listen to the show every Monday at 11 or subscribe to the podcast by searching for Southern Remedy with your preferred podcasting app.
All righty, welcome back, Horticulture Center. What, Java? You're about to say something.
Yeah, I was about to say, I have a picture here of you with Sarah from Eggville.
Really?
Yeah, I'll show you this picture. I don't have time
Java,
to print it out.
This is creepy. You young people can find weird stuff.
No, because you guys are at the library, right? The Fulton Library.
Yeah,
I see you. Yeah, and she you have your shirt and the mohawk. Yeah, I'll show it to you.
Okay, was I holding my stomach in?
You were holding your thumbs up.
Okay. Way to put it. By the way, the heirloom plant I've been digging garlic this past week. I mean, drying the garlic flowers, digging the garlic, spreading out to dry. It smells funky in my little cabin. But also, the altheas have started blooming. There's one at the Agriculture Museum. They got a little doctor's herb garden. If you haven't been to the Ag Museum, cool place. Great place to take kids. And they got a little small town.
And the Pickle Fest is, I believe, next weekend. So it's a great time to go to the Ag Museum.
I went to it last year. Yeah. I went to it. I got some pickle. It was wild.
Yeah, the Pickle Fest. So it's a good time to go next weekend.
Well, if you go there, small town, they got the doctor's office. And behind it is a herb garden that Master Gardener's taking care of. And it's being redone. They got a culinary garden there that's got all sorts of stuff that you can grow that look pretty and you can cook with it. You know, edible flowers, culinary herbs, got a few spices. Spices are basically seeds and bark and roots and stuff, you know, and herbs are usually leaves. But anyway, they've got a big althea, a rose of Sharon, that's a sort of a medium pink with splashes of deep pink in it. That came from a guy named Jim Wilson, who used to be the southern host for the Victory Garden, and he gave me this cutting, a cutting for this from his home in South Carolina. and it's coming in full bloom. Altheas or Rose of Sharon, one of the coolest, most dependable, summer blooming, grows in a cemetery, dead people can grow it, don't have to do anything to it, shrubs you can have. They're terrific. And the Vitex around town with the spikes of blue flowers, they are electric. We're having trouble with crepe myrtles, but between Vitex and Althea, you can, and gardenias, you can have some good summer color.
And it's always good, those connections with the flowers, because you see a flower growing, but it, you never know where it come from.
Yeah, yeah. Well, anyway, I broke this branch off. I might just take it home and root it.
There you go.
So anyway, we've been yakking about gardening this morning. Every Friday, live, rebroadcast on Saturdays, along with many, many other programs here on Mississippi Public Broadcasting. Monday through Friday and sometimes on Saturdays. So if you tune in to a podcast, download it, listen to it later, and if anything I can help you with, shoot us an email. Go to felderrushing.blog. Meanwhile, the farmers markets have been going to farmers markets, and they are rocking and rolling. Garden Center's got lots of plants. There's all sorts of stuff we can do to have a, to enhance what we do at home. So go to a garden center. Go to a farmer's market. Talk to the people who grow those plants. Take a kid with you, because it's real, real important for us to show them how to do what we do best. I'm going to mention that in just a second, but we got like another minute.